Yeah, one time a woman was at a lady's house in Germany, and we had, on the highway, we had a woman going by day and night, and she says, "Oh, no, that's not American, they just run around in circles." I said, "No, they're not just going around in circles, those are all our people." Oh, yeah, one time I was... I was driving these German prisoners. I was taking them down into the... This was like when the war ended, and I was driving these German prisoners. And I was taking them down into the woods. There was a bush down. And I hold the door. And then one day I lined them up. One of the Germans said, "Show the Americanist soldat and met the machine gun there. He would know how to use it." He said, "Look at that there young American with that machine gun. He wouldn't know how to use it because I look so young." They all went down in the wood. I opened fire and they all went down in it. And they lay down. But the tree above. So then they come back up. And he saluted me, and they all lined up. "I ain't quiet, but I ain't been." He saluted me and everything. I put them in their place. A lot of story like that.
You'll notice that when Alfred was reciting the coordinates that he was given to position his tank gun, and he was going over the coordinates, and to this day, it, what was pointed out is when Alfred goes for coordinates and they say firing, that's this. Because he's firing the gun. And it's kind of what's really emblematic and testament to the memories that you guys have from World War II. And that's a thing that I'm forever amazed by is these memories are just as strong now as when they were kids, maybe a little bit different, but it still remains very, very much a part of who they are now and how they remember World War II. This is a scary time for a 17-year-old, right? Actually, 18, probably when you were in the thick of it. I think in 45, right? You were 18, right around there? You the same, right? 19. Are there any questions while we have the guys here? Any questions? Yeah. Want to pass a microphone over to Fred?
Sure. I forget to tell you how that trip finished up. Well, in the middle of the storm, one of the tankers broke its back. It got picked up by a wave in the middle of it. We were still make way. And unfortunately, we were assigned the job of escorting it into St. John's, Newfoundland, while the convoy went out. So we got it up there into Newfoundland. Once we got it settled foot there, we took off from New York. We got to make it. We went full speed all the way, but we arrived just off New York half an hour after they closed the nets. All the major ports, you know, steel nets that they closed at night so submarines couldn't slip in. So we got there about a half an hour after they closed the nets. So we spent New Year's Eve anchored off Long Island. We could see the lights of Coney Island, but that's how we spent our New Year's Eve, watched Coney Island. The rest of the convoy had made it okay.
Questions for yourself? Yes, sir.
Consigli, I knew your unit was in the Hurricane Forest. Were you in the Hurricane Forest to battle?
Yes, we were, yeah.
Tell them the story about the bombers going
overhead. Oh, I was in the Hurricane Forest. I stepped out of the day. I hear the big roar. And I see so many planes going over to Germany that the sun would block the sun. American planes. Orville and right up overhead. It was near Christmas time. They were shooting one American plane down at a time. They don't break formation. They were just knocking them all down. I looked up and I said, what a present they're getting back in the States. There's all enlisted men and officers in those planes. I'll never forget that. There's thousands and thousands of planes. Yes. And, oh, yeah. Then, oh, yeah. Let me tell you one more story. Yeah. Let's see now. We had the Battle of the Bulge. I remember being in Belgium. And we fight a few rounds. I don't know where, but we find over in the enemy territory. In the infantry, they were playing ball because the Germans were all surrendering. The Americans were playing balls and everything. But what they didn't know was that's when they started the Battle of the Welsh. So then I traveled 50 miles outside of there, 50 miles in the tank. And we're going down the hill near this here little town, and there's an infantry guy says, go up this way, go up this way. We start going up that way, and there was little dead Germans and American soldiers all over the road. And we had our tank had to run over the American soldiers' legs. And we went up to the hill, and there were dead Germans and Americans all over the place. I still can see them. And then the thing is, they had trenches all over the house, like in World War I, deep trenches. There were American soldiers and Germans in there, all dead. And then I looked on the other side, there was another trench. I see the German P-38 there, because I was still collecting stuff. I went down there and I picked it up, had a little blood on it. I put it in the tank, and then the sergeant said, let's have some KM1 rations. He made something to eat, and I didn't have any place to put my mess kit, and there's a house there. I want to put on the windowsill. I start walking over there. There's a dead body underneath there. I stood on his back. I start eating, and then I look down, and I see the holster for that gun. This is no lie. I went down there, and I fished his pocket, and they had the holster. I took the holster, I had all blood on it. I fished his pocket, and there it was a picture of an officer. He just got married, but he was dead underneath there. And that was his gun in the holster. I put it. Huh? Yeah, it was the Nazi sword in the wedding picture, yeah. But I still don't understand why they had those trenches there and all those American soldiers and Germans all dead all over the field. I think about it all the time. I don't know why those trenches didn't. Nobody knows nothing about it. And they never mentioned. Why were those trenches there? Like in World War I, that's what they had. They were deep. Dead Americans and Germans all over the field and everything. Oh, then one day we went up, we always point over those colognes, begin with a K. And all of a sudden, we are asleep in the tank. Well, daybreak. I see the ball of fire coming across the tank with a German 88. It went right up over the tank. I kicked the driver. I said, back the tank up. We backed the tank up. The next round came 4 feet off the ground. It would have knocked that thing right up. We had a sheep right in the tank. I'll never forget that either. Just lucky.
Any more questions?
I see if what it, it'll fit for
Thank
you. Alfred, can you hear me? Two-part question. You said you took the physical to Boston at a young age. So where did you grow up? Part one. And part two, after you had your break in Brussels from medical fatigue, how long was it before you got rotated back to the front lines?
I grew up in Milford, Mass. Yep. There wasn't much time right away. Then I was on the front line all the time. I just never get it, I'm just lucky. You know? My last name is Consigli. I don't know if you ever heard of my cousin, that a Consigli Construction Company. They're the largest construction company in New England. Yeah.
Other questions? Yes, sir. I'll let you bring the microphone back, or maybe come up a little bit. I don't know how far this reaches here. There you go.
This is a question for McKenna. Did you, when you were in the Pacific, did you ever get to see the New Jersey or the Enterprise?
Did you ever get to see the New Jersey or the Enterprise when you were in the Pacific?
So, just to clarify, Fred, you were, as part of the USS Quick, when you were on that boat, you were in the, I believe that Fred was in a European theater, right? So Fred was on a destroyer going up into Italy.
You did both, right?
Yeah. I'm sorry, I misheard that. So the question again, did he see the... Fred, when you were in the Pacific Theater, did you see the USS, is it New Jersey, right? Yeah, can you see the New Jersey? Fred, I don't know if you caught that. Mm-mm. Fred went to Japan right after the bombs were dropped. Right?
About 6 or 7 months after the most.
Describe a little bit about what that was like.
Well, it was like, you know, I remember in a very minor way. You might remember when all the forest fires went through Yellowstone Park. Well, we had to go over to Yellowstone Park after the fires. There was nothing but dead trees and ashes. Well, that's the way Nagasaki was. There were no complete buildings standing. There were some frames of buildings. Like I said, every time you took a step, ashes would come up. It was a real sobering. Sometimes I even think of one thing that kind of struck me. One day we allowed to go over to Nagasaki, but we were taken on a tour by a missionary. You know, in Nagasaki there were kind of two ranges of mountains that came down like that. And ground zero was in the just over on the other side.
Hold it close.
There was a monastery. So we were able to take a trip to the monastery. The only thing that happened to them, because they were on the right side, they lost part of their roof. But the blast went over them. That was quite interesting to go talk to them monks over there. But, They were there when the bomb dropped, but the only thing they lost was their part of their roof. Somebody must have gone out for them.
Mr. Consigli, how many people are in one tank, and how many tanks are there in a battalion?
That's a good question.
There's five people in the tank. I don't know if we had like A company, B company, C company, and headquarters company. And a lot of them were in, a lot of something company we never heard of. They were at the Holocaust, so. But they never told me nothing. I was a gunner. The sergeant would tell me what to do. And the first sergeant, he'd go to the CP, and the officer tells him what to do. And then the first sergeant come and tell my sergeant what to do. I'm just sitting there. And that was it. One time, we were in France, and this officer says, "Sergeant, take this road here." And then my sergeant says, "I'm not going down there, that's suicide." And then the officer says, "All right, take the next road." I took the next road, and I was firing a machine gun 32 inches high. And then we hear it on the radio, get out, the other tank got it. But I don't know why that sergeant refused an order. He says, "I'm not going down there." But the other tank had knocked out that he sent down there. Stuff like that. Yeah, he was from Morgantown, West Virginia. And he liked General Pat. He named it. He named that first tank Blood and Guts. Yeah. He was a nice guy, though. Yeah, I remember him. He was married, too. There's a lot of married people, and, you know. Yeah.
Maybe we'll take one or two more questions? Yes, sir. Why don't you come up? Come up this way. There we go. Question, Mr. Consigli. Whatever happened to that captured P-38 from the dead German officer?
That's another story. This guy by the name of Jackie Felt, he used to help me once in a while. He was my friend. He lived in Milford. And instead of giving him the money, I gave him the P-38. And then he died. And his son took it. And then I got it from his son. And then my house burnt down. And all the rifles were in there. They were down at the police station. The P-38 was there too. Of course, I had German 22s and a couple other 22s. And I went down, it cost me money to get them out of there now. And that guy invented it. I said, "If you go there and get all my guns," I said, "if you can have the P-38. He went down there to get a gun. I gave him a P-38. I don't know what he still got it. That poor guy, he was an officer, he was a young guy, just married. I fished his pocket, you know. There was blood all over the holster. I was in the tank cleaning it off. And my sergeant said, "What are you doing now?" I said, "I'm cleaning this gun." He took the thing and threw it out of the tank. He said, "Oh, boy, picking stuff up." And one time we went in a bank, and there was German marks all over the floor, over my combat boots. I took two cigar boxes and I filled them all up, and they all said, "Oh, that money's no good." I said, "Well, I'll send them home for souvenirs." He took one box, he threw it out of the tank. After a while, I put it back in the tank. And when the war ended, I was in Salzburg, Austria. I was there for 6 months. I went to the bank, I tried to cash it in. I cashed in a little at a time. I sent my mother home over $1,000. That's when you used to send your mother all the money, you know? And the money was good. I wouldn't fill up my parents' bag. Yeah.
The question was, how many tanks were in a battalion? And it's 68 tanks.
And four companies.
68 tanks in battalion and four companies.
Thank you.
All right, gentlemen. I think, Alfred, are you guys going to hang around a little bit if folks want to come up, ask some questions? And Alfred, you have all of these pictures here of your adventure, and I'm sure folks would love to hear some of your stories. So maybe if you want to hang out next to pictures for a little bit. Again, we so thank you for being here today. It's been a really long week for all of us. Oh, sorry. It's been a long week for all of us, and your being here means a lot to us, and we thank you for it. If you look here, one of our great